Alright, this is John Colo with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. This one's going to be a fun one at that. What I'm going to show you guys today is right here, just a standard urban household. I'm here in Irving, Texas today in the south. And why I'm here today is actually to show you guys a farm. And actually how I came to come to this farm was actually yesterday, as I travel most times, whenever I travel, I always go to the farmer's market, make it a point to visit local farmer's markets wherever I am, so I could buy local fresh fruits and vegetables and food, right? So anyways, as it was, I was at the farmer's market, I was walking by a bunch of the different farmers' tables and whatnot, and I saw this farmer selling some stuff, and I just passed by, you know, it was kind of curious and interesting, but I just passed by, nothing really caught my eye or anything. I walked around the whole farmer's market, and then actually found me. He's like, hey, John. I'm like, hey, what's up? And he knew me because he watches my videos. So we got to chatting, and he gave me his card. I'm like, hey, man, you're around, like, maybe tomorrow or something. I could come by and, like, check out your place and make a video. And so, anyways, I'm here. That's how it happened. And the cool story that I want to share with you guys today is, you know, about a few things, right? Number one, you guys are going to learn today what grows really well here in Irving, Texas, in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And also down here in the south. Number two, how you could literally turn your hobby into a business. So literally the farm that I'll be showing you guys today started only 6 months ago. It's amazing that in just 6 months he's now creating an income for him and his family. I don't know the exact numbers that he's making, but maybe it's between like $300 to $500 a week he's producing on the farm behind me. You know, he just bought a house. It's actually a fairly large house, older house, probably needs some work, but it's about a 0.85 of an acre. So it's over 3/4 of an acre. He has a lot of space to play with. And he's actually utilizing some of the techniques that another popular YouTube channel, a guy that actually I had on and interviewed, Curtis Stone. He was using a lot of Curtis Stone techniques to actually really make a really good income for him and his family. Also get family members, his wife and his mom, involved with growing on the farm and having them do work and supporting the family and the household. So this is a completely amazing idea, and I really want you guys to, you know, if this tickles your fancy or you guys see how he's doing it, hey, look up Curtis Stone. You know, I'll put a link down below to the video that I made with Curtis on how you guys could start your own farm, whether it's using your own land like he's doing, or OPL, other people's land, or OPP, other people's property, to garden and farm on so that you guys can create an income. It's an amazing what you could do if you have a little bit of gumption and you know get taught how to do this, and you could like quit your job. I mean, literally the other cool thing about the farmer here, he was working for Microsoft. He got laid off. So he went from Microsoft to growing microgreens and other leafy greens and other vegetables on his farm. So I think that's just something really cool. Whether you're laid off or whether you just hate your job and you would love to just farm and garden and create your own income, you guys could do it. And at this farm today, we're gonna show you guys how they do it here. So let's head across the road without getting hit and show you guys how they're growing here at Braga Farms in Irving, Texas. So the first thing I wanna show you guys is actually the fence line right here. He put up this fence after he moved onto the property, and I think fences are probably a really good idea. He's got things planted outside the fence line, like mint, that'll actually just spread out and take over and make like a nice border between his property and his fence line. But on his fence line, he's actually also growing things. One of my favorite kind of bushes or trees, it's a Rosa rugosa. So he's growing these for the rose hips, you know, a really high vitamin C food, and also a really excellent crop. Also makes nice, good looking flowers that you could probably sell, you know, as cut flowers, and also will create a nice border with thorns so that people will not want to, you know, venture in to his space. Aside from growing that, on the other side he's growing up, actually, he's got some different hardy kiwis, he's got some okra and sunflowers growing up on the other side fence. And then beyond the fence, you guys can see, just has rows and rows of greens. Now he's really specializing in certain greens. He kind of went to the farmer's market to do his research to find out what sells at the farmer's market. And he saw what sells, and then he's just growing those crops, and also crops that actually are really easy for him to grow, that also other farmers during this time of year, which is actually the summer, today was like in the 97 degrees, maybe 100. Other farmers are not simply growing, and he's got some special techniques that allows him to grow these crops so that he could be the only one for example, with lettuce. Not that I recommend you guys grow lettuce here in Texas in the middle of summer. Not my first choice, but hey, he's able to do it using some of the techniques, and I hope to share those with you guys. So anyways, let's head inside the gate and show you guys the farm. So one of the cool things about this farm is that he was only started 6 months ago. So, I mean, one of the techniques he's using is what I call the shotgun technique, right? He's planting a lot of different things to see what does well and what doesn't do well. He also has research before he started planting and doing the shotgun approach. He researched, you know, some of the different plants and vegetables that do well in the area. I mean, just a few doors down, there's a farmer that's been growing for like 45 years. So that's kind of been like his guidance and his mentor to help get started and help get growing. Anyways, along this fence line on the inside, he's got rosemary, which are small now, but rosemary will love this climate. He's gonna have big, huge rosemary bushes. He'll be able to sell rosemary for days, right? So that's kind of more of a perennial crop at the fence line. And then over inside here, he's got rows and rows of greens. You know, we're underneath a big tree right now. Maybe this is a oak tree or something. But even underneath the oak tree, you know, the greens are growing. Now, right under the oak tree, like in the front part, the greens aren't so big because it's maybe not getting so much sun. But if you look further, deeper down, where they kind of get some sun, it's still under the oak tree, but it gets some diagonal sun. The greens are much, much larger. And, you know, he doesn't care that it's not optimal, it's not growing to the biggest ability. That's all right. If this takes an extra 2-3 weeks before he harvests it, it's fine with him. And if you see the white powder, you know, he's growing using organic methods. So he's got the diatomaceous earth that helps with some of the bugs. But yeah, so this is an easy crop to grow. I would encourage you guys to actually grow and eat some arugula. It could help with your, have friends that actually eat it for their blood pressure. Also, it's nice, hot, and spicy. And the other thing about arugula is that it is a fast, vigorous grower. It's one of the crops that actually you could grow, cut, and turn, and you know, sell very quickly compared to, you know, other greens out there. All right, so besides the arugula here, he's also growing another crop that I want to share with you guys. So besides the arugula, the other crop that he really specializes in are the radishes. And as you guys can see over on this side is the arugula. This side is almost ready to get harvested, and he'll basically just cut them down flat, and then basically they're gonna come again and grow back. And I've had a bunch of the arugula here. I mean, once again, 97 degrees today, I think, maybe around 100. Arugula is spicy, but check it out, right? He's found people at the market that buy his arugula that love his arugula because it's so spicy. You go to the health food store or this market, right, and buy arugula, that baby arugula, it tastes like nothing. You know, and especially when the plants have some of the strong flavor overtones, whether it's lettuce that tastes stronger or the arugula, that's actually healthier for us to eat when it tastes stronger. And the heat makes it basically have these phytonutrients so that the plant has these phytonutrients so that it protects itself from the sun. So yeah, definitely some good arugula here. Cut and come again. And then on the radishes, those ones just grow really fast. Some radishes could be done in as low as 30 days, 25 days, he could have a whole radish. And let's not forget that the radish greens are edible. Normally I think he just probably pulls the radishes and sells them up in as bunches, but he could actually separate them out and sell the radishes separately from the radish greens and sell them as the radish greens. Most people don't know that they could eat them, but you can, and creating a new market for radish greens might be a little bit difficult unless you can maybe sample them out, or maybe you could pickle them or do some kind of value-added process to them. I think it'd be quite interesting to actually do radish green kale chips. You know how they make kale chips? Just use the radish tops to make the kale chips with a good, nice sauce that you dehydrate. I think that'd be quite interesting. Anyways, I want you guys always, you know, if you're gonna be your own business, your own boss, which I encourage you guys, I mean, I'm an entrepreneur myself, and I think everybody should own their own business and not have to work for the man. You have to be really creative and efficient with your time. And so one of the things, you know, working at Microsoft, what he's done is he was a systems guy. So he created systems within Microsoft, you know, so that he could actually just give to people so that people could follow these systems and, you know, they could make more money in the company. But now coming into being his own farmer, you know, he's creating systems here to save himself time and labor so he could be as efficient as possible and maximize, you know, his return on the investment. And he's doing it quite well. So as you guys can see behind me, here's another area of his front yard that actually has a lot more greens growing. Basically, once again, arugula and radishes, what he specializes in. there's always an area that's ready to get harvested and always areas that are growing. So he's planted these in multiple areas so that every week he could show up to the farmer's market and have his radishes and arugula, which he's known for. But aside from that, he's growing a lot of other different crops in much smaller quantities. So as much as he's always gonna have a radishes and arugula, he might have some tomatoes, some squash, some, you know, basil, some different kind of herbs, always as well. And, you know, the one thing I wanna let you guys know that what he's learning is don't get down if something's not growing well, right? It happens to the best of us, even me, right? In this area, he has some cucumbers that he's planted, and these plants are not doing basically anything, right? And that's all right, because he's not only planted the cucumbers here, so all his eggs are not in one basket, literally, proverbial. He planted cucumbers in the back where they're actually doing much better. And so, you know, use your space you have to experiment, right? And that's another big process, and like nobody could tell you really to like, oh, plant the cucumbers there, they're gonna do really well. You don't really know until you try it. The soil's a bit different. It gets different, you know, sun or shade based on some of the trees that are around. And sometimes plants don't do well in a certain area because the soil's not quite right. And basically, he moved in this property. It was all like grass and like weeds and whatnot. So he took basically a sodder, which is like the machine that actually they take to actually dig up and make sod so that you could actually plant the sod in your, you know, front yard to have instant grass. But he basically took out sod patches of this whole yard and removed it to get rid of the grass and all the weeds in place. And he's left with basically the soil underneath, whatever was underneath there. And he's used a little bit of fertilizer underneath, but mostly this is just the ground. So, you know, he's working on currently building the soil. He's been bringing in things like the compost and also lots of wood chips, which actually I want to talk to you guys next about. But before I leave this shot, I also want to mention, I don't know if you guys can see, but basically he's growing a lot of sunflowers way back over here. And sunflowers, that's another good crop you guys could use, not only to make biomass or the greenage that you could actually then compost in, but also to create an income. You know, I don't know if you just had a home garden. I don't know that I necessarily grow sunflowers, maybe a couple because they look nice. I would personally grow the black oilseed sunflowers because besides having pretty sunflowers to look at, and besides having the green matter, you could actually grow the black oil seed sunflowers out to have the sunflower seeds, which then you could actually turn into microgreens and use that to grow microgreens. So you could actually grow your own seed for your microgreens. And actually he's growing microgreens actually inside a climate controlled area of his house, which actually I talked to him about because one of the things at the farmer's market when I saw him, he sells a whole tray of microgreens for like 10 bucks. And I'm like, wow, man, in my head, I'm like, that place, that's a good guy for growing, for buying microgreens, because he's selling them for so cheap for a whole tray. Now, they could have been a little bit, you know, larger, a little bit more grown out, but that's all right. You could get them home, and then you could grow them out a couple more days before you eat them. But for $10 for microgreens, I'm like, how are you making any money? And we talked about it. He's like, you know what, John? I have about $3 into it for growing the microgreens. So I'm like making $7 every flat I sell, because he's just that efficient with his resources, buying in bulk, and actually even sourcing some of his own materials to use to grow the microgreens in that I actually haven't really heard about or seen before. So really interesting. Anyways, let's go ahead and take a look at the wood chip pile, a major source of upcoming fertility, but a real good source of current weed suppression. All right, so now I'm gonna show you guys actually the wood chips and the techniques he's using, which is actually something I would recommend for you guys as well. It's quite smart. This area actually, he sodded, so he dug up all the grass. He has big piles, which actually I'll show you guys in a minute what he's doing with it, which is also super intelligent and super good. But he sodded this and took it all out, but then because he has to like dedicate time to so many other different things, building structures, putting in infrastructure, planting out gardens, he hasn't been able to like, you know, take care of this. So he sodded it, and then the stuff grew all back. So now what he's doing is he's taking actually cardboard, and he's putting down a couple layers of cardboard, very important. He's actually got some really nice cardboard here, like big huge boxes, not like produce boxes that have holes in it because weeds will grow up through that. He's got a couple layers, and then you can see basically over there he's got some bricks on the cardboard for now so that it doesn't blow away until he gets all the wood chips. So he gets an arborist in the area to dump wood chips down here, and he basically just spreads it on all this cardboard. And even if he does this, right, the weeds still might grow up through that, but that's all right, right? If that happens, then he just re-cardboards and puts more mulch down on top to cover them up even more, and that's actually what he's gonna be doing way over there. But the reason why he's doing that, one of the reasons is these, man. These things are nasty. I'm so glad I don't have any of these, and before I go home, I'm going to check my person, check my body, check my shoes, because these things are nasty. Like, foxtails are nasty, but these things are nastier. These are like really sharp, like pointy things, and if you're walking barefoot, man, they'll hurt you. And if you're a cat or a dog, man, these could really mess a cat or a dog up too. So basically, he wants to really eradicate these guys. I don't know exactly what they are, but yeah, really a pain. But yeah, so that's that. And so meanwhile, while he's suppressing weeds with all the wood chips, right, over time, maybe a couple, 3 years, they're gonna break down slowly and compost, and then he'll be able to basically scratch this stuff back and go underneath and grab up all the nice black rich gold, and then basically sift it out, sift off all the small stuff, and then add that to his raised garden beds. So he's creating fertility, also suppressing the weeds, one of the most important and intelligent things, in my opinion, you guys should also be doing. You know, I'm using the wood chips in between my pathways because I don't have a lot of space on my backyard garden. But if you have, you know, literally 0.85 an acre like he does, he can't possibly grow in every area yet because he only started 6 months ago. You know, definitely mulching with sheet mulching cardboard and the wood chips would probably be one of my first goals just for the whole thing. And then as I need, I would actually remove it back and then, you know, start planting stuff out. So what he's done when he dug up basically all the sod that came up to try to get rid of the weeds and eradicate them to reveal the soil underneath that he's then sheet mulching on, he basically got like tree logs and stumps from the arborist. Once again, nice big ones. And he's basically created quote unquote beds with them. He's lining them around, and then all the sod went in the middle. As you guys can see, there's still lots of weeds actually coming up out of those. So it might be better to do a little bit more control on that. But basically he's letting these areas kind of go wild, and he's actually thrown in things like wild flowers and some native plants. And this is a really good thing to do on your guys' farm or your garden to basically create an area of and a habitat for beneficial insects. You know, some of the different pollinators, some of the different beneficial bugs, you know, will actually come and live in this area because of the natives. And then they'll also, because they're here, they'll go out to your garden and help you pollinate and help also eat the bad bugs. And so this is one of the techniques that I don't see too often on farms or even backyard gardens. And I think it actually is really important, you know, based on talking to some people that are doing this on a much larger scale and actually have, you know, basically hedgerows of native and wildflowers and things. I mean, it's really important to create a system, you know, in your garden or your farm, and this is actually part of the system that I think is often, unfortunately, left out. So what you guys are looking at now are some squash that he was growing, and you're probably thinking, John, that's squash. That stuff don't look too good. And it's got some white powder over it. Well, the white powder is a diatomaceous earth. He's also tried to, like, apply neem oil and other things here to control some insects that actually damage I've only ever seen this trip to Texas, right? Squash vine borers. I don't have these in the West where I live. I would encourage you guys to move if you guys have these guys, because man, this is like totally getting decimated. Now the thing is, he's got about a month of production out of them before the squash vine borers came in really strong and started taking out his plants. And as you guys can see, you know, some of the plants are totally basically taken out, but some of them are actually still producing despite the squash vine borers. So he gets out here whenever he can and tries to manually control them, which is probably one of the things I would encourage you guys to do. The other thing I would recommend is actually just, you know, cover your plants, you know, build a hoop house, you know, or, you know, hoops, have hoops over your crops to basically cover them up to exclude the squash vine borers. Another thing you could do is get smarter than them, you know, grow something like the butternut squash. I think that's immune to the squash vine borers, and you could harvest them young to use them like a summer squash, right? There's always techniques and ways to, you know, prevent or, you know, be smarter and outsmart the pests. I don't really know a lot of techniques myself for the squash vine borers because I've never had them. And man, it looks like one atrocious problem. If you guys have any, you know, suggestions for squash vine borers, hey, put it down below so that we could all learn from your guys' experience. So now I want to show you guys actually some of the main parts of his farm with actually he's growing underneath cover. So, you know, unlike using a shade cloth or other things, you know, he wants to be more environmentally, you know, friendly. You know, some of the shade cloths are made out of like plastic material that basically, hopefully they last a long time, but some of them degrade and they get all nasty, and you can only use them a couple seasons before they basically turn into dust and you gotta throw them away. Instead of using that standard polypropylene shade cloth stuff that can actually get quite expensive, although it can be reused. He was using something a lot smarter, in my opinion, that actually I haven't seen before, right? He's using actually the burlap. So he's got basically rolls of burlap, strung them out over the top. Burlap is a natural material, right? He could use it to shade things out. It might last a couple seasons before the sun really, you know, beats it down, breaks it down. But then guess what? After that, he just turns it into compost, and then later it's gonna end up feeding his plants. How intelligent is that? So anyways, he put up these big poles, these big fence posts. They're 10 feet tall. He's got 2 feet into the ground, sunk into concrete in the bottom. And basically at the top, he just took a drill bit, one of the ones that actually has, it looks like a little funnel thing. I forget, they're self-adjusting drill bits. It's like the bit for holes. And then he basically drilled holes at the top, and he basically runs rebar, because rebar is really inexpensive, between them, to basically use it to tie up strings and actually also support all the different burlap over the top. Now his goal with the top of this is actually to run more different rebar and have like a trellis network up top and up some of those different supports. He's growing things like loofah gourds. He's growing things like maybe grapes and also bitter melon, that hopefully he would actually have a living top up over the top that actually would help shade out his crops down below. And if things grew in too tightly up top, guess what? Then he'd just trip back and open it up so that, you know, he could get some more light down below. So in this way, he's using more of his vertical space and actually growing crops up top that actually can produce him an income, you know, such as the loofahs or, you know, the grapes, or even you could do kiwis like this. Lots of crops like to grow in vine. And so this is really intelligent. Let's go ahead and go over and show you guys actually some of the things he's growing in there and how he's controlling even more weeds below his crops. So now I'm amongst some of his lettuce that he actually has growing down over here, and he's using some standard weed cloth that he actually built a jig out of wood, aka Curtis Stone, with holes in certain predefined areas. He basically then put the weed cloth underneath, and he basically just burned out the holes. So I mean, it's not quite as clean as a job I did with the circle cutter, but it's sure heck of a lot faster. And basically he's growing lettuce underneath shade. Now, the lettuce here, I'll be honest with you, it's actually bolting rather quickly. It's growing up a little bit and then it bolts, but that's all right, because as soon as it starts to get a little bit tall, he'll cut it off. And guess what? He's the only one at the farmer's market with lettuce, because nobody else is gonna waste their time. The other thing, he has a cover overhead, so that actually helps a little bit. And also he has lots of lettuce growing, like a whole row, and they're spaced really close, together. Maybe like, 6-inch spacing, like super close. Over on this side, he's growing the lettuce, but also aside from that, he has a chard in a middle row, which is actually growing really well. And also he has some onions growing that's actually looking to do really well as well. And on the sides here, up the fence, oh look, here's a bitter melon. You guys can't see, that's probably right outside the camera. And he has bitter melons growing up, and that's because that's what he wants to shade over the top, just hasn't grown fast enough, so that's why he got the burlap. And then over here, he's got lots of different cherry tomatoes that actually look nice and healthy plants growing up on both sides. And he's using string off the top to come down, and he's using some locally sourced bamboo stakes that he didn't buy, that he actually just harvested, from a area that is actually growing bamboo close by. So it's basically free resources. Let me show you guys some other free resources actually he secured locally, and you guys might be able to secure locally also. So the farmer here is a chronic Craigslister. That means he goes on Craigslist and checks out the free section like every day to find out if there's anything good he could actually use. He's got these big wooden spools that he kind of uses for shells, which actually you could probably turn into a really nice compost tumbler. He also got like some of this trellis material that he's actually growing this loofah up right behind me. And if you guys look at this pathway that I'm sitting on, it looks like it's like stone tiles, but actually it's not really stone pathway material. It's actually roof shingles that are made out of tile or concrete that actually basically has pathways. Now, yeah, this stuff's pretty thin. You gotta have a nice base to it, a couple of cracks, but actually it creates actually nice pathways in his garden that he's all got for free. And you know, there's many resources that may be local and available to you, whether they're on Craigslist, whether they're maybe a good trusted source of a farm that creates manure from the animals, or your neighbors that have horses, or maybe like an arborist or a tree trimmers that are basically have all these wood chips. you guys can secure these for free and put them to good use, whether it's to grow up your plants or make good walkways, or more importantly, to build your soil. So here's another part of his farm, and actually it's kind of like in the corner of his lot actually, and it's underneath a tree or a couple of trees that is actually not on his property. So you can maybe like trim off some of the ones that are hanging over, but for the most part he leaves them. And in this area, even underneath the tree, he's growing leafy greens. And I know a lot of you guys may have like, John, I can't have a garden, man. I have a tree and it shades out everything. I mean, this is literally like 5 foot away from the trunk, and this tree, the limbs spread out like, I don't even know, 50 feet, like at least another 10 feet over that direction. But check this out, over in this area, even in this shadier spot, because it gets like indirect sunlight, maybe some sun shines through some of the, you know, not super dense canopy above, he has lots of greens growing. So in this area, he has things like the Siberian kale, one of my favorites. He also has lots of red Russian kale. All the way down, look at that row, man. It's nice and long, and he's got this, weed blocker that he's actually burned the holes through to plant in specific planting areas. So I think that's actually quite a good technique. He's using it mainly for weed suppression, but it also, depending on where you live, could be helpful for moisture suppression as well. Let's see, what else did I want to cover over here? Yeah, and then over here he has, tomatoes, using just some small bamboo stakes growing up. And so the points are, even in the shady spot, he's growing lots of stuff. And this area also had a crop failure. So a dismal crop failure. He tried to do spinach and just didn't do anything. And the tip is, in my opinion, the spinach, standard spinach just doesn't like it too warm. And probably the soil may not have been good enough to warrant the spinach. And I grow spinach in the off season, and even then it grows a little bit slow. So aside from just growing the radishes, the arugula, and some lettuce, he has more things growing over here, including lots of basil. If it was me, you know, I'd probably grow more basil, because basil is more appropriate for his climate here. Now, there may be other people growing basil, and that might not be so good because you have a lot of competition, but a lot of people love to eat basil. And so what I would recommend is also, you know, take a look at your geographic location and see what crops do really well that you could almost like grow blindfolded. Like here in Texas, the basil is gonna do amazing. And the thing I want you guys to remember is, besides just the standard Italian basil that he's growing a lot of, he also has things like the Thai basil. But there's many other different kinds of basil, at least three dozen different varieties. Lemon basil, lime basil, Genovese is standard basil, Mrs. Burns basil. And I would encourage farmers and you guys to grow different varieties, because you'll learn that some varieties may grow better or worse. But the other thing is, especially because he also deals with local restaurant owners and chefs, you know, you could have some different kind of like cinnamon basil, so that they could, you know, use that and flavor their dishes a little bit differently than the standard basil. And, you know, people that are into foodies and all this stuff are kind of into some of these unique and rare things, and that could be a good thing. But also growing these unique and rare things could also be a bad thing, because people like what they like, and they know basil is this stuff here. And if you're growing some different one, you know, some Thai basil, unless they're from, you know, Thailand, they might not be buying it. So you kind of got to weigh out your options. But yeah, for me, I'd be growing a lot more basil, does well. Also, he's just finishing up with his cilantro. You know, he has it under shade. It's actually finally been bolting. He said that did quite well for him. As well as, of course, he's got some Swiss chard, another proven winner in the heat of Texas here. So on the farm here, what you're gonna notice is that there is a high turnover of crops. You know, it's not like a fruit tree, you plant the fruit tree once and it's just sitting there, and every year you harvest the fruits off it. You don't have to ever replant it. Here, because they have quick turn crops, which is very important to actually make some decent income on your farm, such as arugula, such as the lettuce, especially in the summer, or such as these radishes that actually just got harvested and sold yesterday. Probably when I saw them at the farmer's market, this crop was basically just harvested, and now there's basically nothing left here except like some small undersized radishes and just the greens. Pretty soon, probably maybe tomorrow even, they're gonna be turning this up and they're gonna be replanting. So the model they use here, they go from greens to roots, roots to greens. So this bed had the radishes. They could go to like maybe a lettuce, or probably more than likely an arugula. And then after the arugula is done, you know, that is actually a better crop because it's actually cut and come again. They could do that a couple times before they actually got to pull it. The radishes, you know, they just actually pull it when they're big enough. So the arugula probably would make more money and less labor overall than radishes. But yeah, that's how they do it here. Turn it from leaves to roots, roots to leaves. Over on this side, once again, more lettuce. Looks like it's doing fairly well. And yeah, on both sides, they have tomatoes trellised upright. And you know, I want to encourage you guys, especially if you have a limited space, to grow things vertically. They're doing an excellent job at that here, up to different, almost every pole for the structure they built. They have actually a plant on every pole going up, and they basically have strings coming off the roof of this structure to support all their tomatoes. And that takes a lot of labor to tie these tomatoes up. So I can't always say that I'm the best at doing that. I try to just cage them up and hopefully they find their way inside, and then occasionally I'll put a leaf inside. But yeah, I mean, I lots of labor to tie these tomatoes up, and they're done really nicely. I could tell that they're staying on top of stuff here. So here's another area and another field they got growing on, and they got all the arugula in the middle, and aside from the arugula, on the edges of the arugula, they actually have a beans mixture. And the beans mixture is not necessarily for sale. Some of them actually are edible, but for the most part, they're actually just to grow up and do a few things. Number one, help shade out the arugula, because this area of the farm is actually not under any cover like the other area. So that actually prevents some sunburn, and maybe keep the arugula a little bit cooler. Also, they're doing it for the nitrogen fixing. So the beans family, legume family of crops, nitrogen fix, and they actually build more fertility in the soil. So this is actually a nice technique they're using here. Now, if it was me, I'd personally probably try to grow some like more edible potted beans that I could kind of maybe turn into a crop as well. But yeah, this area actually looks nice, lush and green. Looks like they've actually added, you know, a fair bit of compost to this area, whereas in other areas that I've been to, they don't quite have as much compost. And yes, compost can actually make quite a difference. So I think the last thing I want to do before we interview the farmer is actually show you guys their compost pile. So what you guys are looking at behind me is their compost pile here on the farm. You might be thinking, John, that looks like rubbish. It doesn't look like anything. They basically got a wire fencing in an area with a pitchfork, so it looks official, like they're making compost. Lots of leaves and maybe some scraps, kitchen scraps in there. But basically, you know, they've only been here 6 months. You know, they haven't had a lot of time to get composting, to, you know, return all the matter back to the soil and generate their own compost here. So they've actually had to bring in compost. Now they're on a budget here, so they actually haven't brought in as much compost as I would like them to, and maybe probably as they would like to either, but they're doing the best they can. So meanwhile, they've been supplementing with some organic fertilizer in some of the beds. And my personal opinion is, do I think they could get better production if they actually added more compost? I think absolutely yes. And it would be one of my goals to do as much composting on site as possible. Every different leaf matter material I could get. And I would probably even go out and seek, you know, compost materials to bring in to make compost and make it one of my goals on the farm to create compost. So for example, go into a juice bar. Juice bars that, you know, create juice out of produce, right? They create lots of waste. Unfortunately, most of it around the country does not actually get composted. It just goes into the landfill. What a waste, right? So all you got to do is combine that juice pulp with like wood chips, and guess what? Voila, you have instant compost in just a couple months. Even if you just pile it up and lasagna style it, so you don't have to be turning it all the time. Even better yet would be to lasagna style it and put some pipes in underneath, some perforated pipes with holes, and run like one of those blowers that like blow up all those big like kids bouncy houses, right? Run that and then run the air through there. It'll happen even faster, so you can make your own compost so that actually you don't have to keep buying the compost. Another way is, you know, talk to different grocery stores. Might be difficult to do this, but talk to grocery stores when they cull the produce and they cut off the edges, the bad parts, the bad peaches and nectarines and apples they throw out that have one little small bad spot, right? Get that stuff and compost that along with the wood chips. And even better yet, right, some of those things besides composting, right, could be fed to the animals. They have animals on site, you know, turkey, chickens, and goats. That could also be fed to the animals to offset the bill for bringing in feed. So there's lots of resources that are available to you guys, and I want you guys to, you know, look at all the different resources and how you could use those and how you could divert them from the landfill. I mean, even a better way would be to start having some worms and introducing worms into the soil, right? So many different ways you could create fertility on your property on the free or cheap. It's insane, all right? So I think the last thing I want to do in this episode is actually interview the farmer and talk more about him, why he actually started, how he got into this, and maybe some of his tips and tricks that he's actually learned in just the 6 months he's been farming. So now I'm here with Jefferson of Braga Farms, and he's started this whole place, but it's not just him alone, right? It's him and his family. So Jefferson, the first question I want to ask you is, you know, why did you decide to start this amazing farm here in just 6 months ago, literally?
Yeah. So it's been a work in progress, right? For the past 5 years, I've always been doing some kind of gardening, whether it's in whether it's at an apartment or a duplex that I lived in or a house, right? We had a garden. So so transitioning over to a house, we just bought this place about a year ago, and we started on the plot right behind us here. 30 by 20. I was like, I want to make something great, and we had some beds come in, you know, cucumbers, which we pickled, basil came in nice, tomatoes didn't come in for nothing, and so just hits and misses, but that's a struggle with gardening. Some things go well. Well,
it's
and
part
some
of the learning process.
Some things
right?
go yeah. Some things not so well. As far as growing my own things, I think it started around 3 years ago. I was buying a lot from. Fiestas, ShopRite, Walmart, all these places, and just biting into some cucumbers and making some of these salads, you just tasted water. You didn't taste the vegetable, just water in the shape of a vegetable. And I got so disappointed with it that I was determined to start changing my ways. I started buying a lot of organic products from Whole Foods, Kroger. Not so much. It was a little subpar compared to Whole Foods I found. And supplementing with my gardening. Last year with the house, it helped me a lot. And then this year, just transitioning from one job to another, I was looking at the property, and my mother moved in last year with us, and I was like, let's garden it out as much as we can. What do we think? I talked to everybody about it, and they were like, okay, can we do it? But like I said, been learning a lot the last 5 years, putting it all to work now.
Wow, it's amazing. So you used to work at Microsoft, right? And how did working at Microsoft help you do what you're doing now?
So starting off at Microsoft, I was a technical account manager, helping account managers with their customers, learning about just really being customer obsessed, helping them really provide value, value from Microsoft offerings to their customer. Following this, I transitioned to business program manager, where I would basically create workflows and systems to help these technical account managers or consultants or different roles within Microsoft. We'd help them with certain tasks that are kind of laborious, such as billing, reviewing low severity cases, severity B and C cases. So we'd look at how can we do those jobs for them, and then who can do those jobs for them faster and at a better cost than us. So I'd look at creating a system, building an infrastructure, building in process, and then transitioning it to a resource that can deliver it consistently and for a longer period of time. And then I'd go on to the next phase, the next level. And this I believe really helped me here on the farm, as well as with other things that I have going on. 6 months ago, had a layoff within the company. Different roles were transitioned offshore, as well as throughout the country. And we looking at that, I was like, hey, I got these four projects that I've been just dying to get my hands into for the past 2 years while I've been at Microsoft. There's no time because it's really demanding. Now's the right time to do it. And I looked at my mother. Sorry about the swatting. So you see all the flies. And So I looked at my mother. She loves gardening. She loves being outside. She was doing some work outside of the house and not really happy. She wanted to be home more. And I saw that, hey, it's a good opportunity to put her to something that she loves. And it's also a great opportunity to give back. I've helped out a lot of folks within my friend, my immediate circle, as well as my community on just, gardening tips and self-sufficiency tips and things like that as well. So. From Microsoft, just learning all those systems, being able to, create steps and workflows on them, and then transition them over to a resource that can be consistent, really helped me out. I love learning, so I've just been accelerating my learning and with the gardenings and how to create refrigeration and make sure that it gets to the market in time. How to how to get the, you know, my foot on the ground and just you know, beat the pavement and get customers and go after some restaurants. Try all the different avenues I've been learning at the same time, but also transitioning that education over to my mother and my wife. And also any friends that are curious on. Some friends have been coming to me, hey, we got to do this at my place. Do I have an acre? I said, hey, dude, I got an acre that I got to take care of on my own. Let me get this down first. You know, we'll work on yours. We'll work on yours next.
So. Wow, yeah, it's amazing. So, yeah, he was in like a sales role. So that sales role helps him sell his produce. And also, since he was in a systems role, it helps him create systems and the infrastructure so that this is successful. And a lot of you guys don't know this about me, but, you know, I came from a background of programming. And programming, you have flow charts and all these the certain ways you're supposed to do things. And I think that's really helped me come up with systems, once again, for my garden, because it's all about, you know, planning and setting up infrastructures. So I think I want to create a t-shirt. Programmers make better gardeners. Now if we could just get more programmers to actually garden and actually eat their food, because I think a lot of programmers, unfortunately, eat too much junk food because they're too busy programming and not getting enough nature connection time and real food time. Anyways, Jefferson, another thing I want to ask you is actually about, like, you know, so you've only been in business now for 6 months. So if you don't mind, how much are you making, like, on a weekly basis nowadays?
Sure. So as you've shown, we've just been dumping a lot of crops on the ground. Yeah. As they come, we harvest them and we're ready. I tried to do restaurants at first because, I just looking at it, it's like, you know, let me get a couple restaurants. Let me see if I can supply them. I don't recommend that just because you're not consistently able to supply them. Unless you have some previous experience or you have a friend that's a restaurant owner and is able to, you know, is able to be more forgiving, I wouldn't recommend going in from lawn to a restaurant. It's just not as forgiving. I recommend going to a farmer's market or a more forgiving kind of sales channel. So right now, after 7 weeks, we've been doing $500 a week. Wow. So after 7 weeks at the market, finally, every week we've grown exponentially. The first week we were there, we did, you know, 200 radishes and arugula sold great, and we've been selling out almost every time. what we also found, and this is with other farmers market or health services or helping services that are attached to farmers market or local markets, it's really good to donate or sell it at a discount into those programs. So anything that we have extra from the farmers market, we then on Monday, so Saturday we go to the market, Monday anything that's extra we can you know go and offload onto you know, we have a WIC program that we have here.
Oh, cool.
So women and children, you know, that are you know underserved and needy, they'll get our produce. However, so far we haven't actually had enough. We haven't had 10 pounds of radish to just give to them, or 5 pounds. We've been selling out pretty well, and the rest we've been eating. So I do recommend looking at, you know, a forgiving sales channel, whether it's a friendly restaurant that's really local, or a farmer's market. Apply really early into the season if you can. One reason why we really pushed hard for the first 3 months that we were starting this, I was working 12-hour, 16-hour days, and really just trying to rush into the season. I was trying. I sodded half the property that I knew I was going to put plots down. I had drawn a little grid on a one note program. And had everything laid out. Almost none of it is actually as laid out as what I imagined. But it's, you know, it gave me, you know, you want a plan so you can work around that plan. We're focused on producing, right? So we want to produce so we can get to a market as soon as possible. Get our feet wet, start selling. Like I said, that's not the best model to go into a restaurant with. Hey, I think I can get you arugula next week. Doesn't always work. Maybe a juicer, maybe a friendly restaurant might work, but not somebody that you want to build a partner relationship.
Yeah, because they'll get pissed really fast, and then they'll badmouth you to everybody else. So it's really not a good idea. So, Jefferson, another question I have for you is, what's been the biggest challenge here on the farm and farming for you?
So my land is really, we're going from lawn to farm. That has been the most challenging because there's just no soil. So the first year, we're really planting in a lot of different locations, trying to see where the soil is better. Because on the outside of our property, we have trees. So a lot of the trees have landed on, you know, and fertilized the areas underneath of the soil. We found is a little bit better. Also, that area, convenient enough, has since it has shading, I can grow lettuce and arugula there a little bit better without the heat suppressing it or scorching it too much. That's been really the hardest part, is just the soil and the amending. The weeding, also very difficult. You want to put down as much to cover it as possible, including in the beds. If you have something that's just going to clutter it out, that's nice. You want to weed before you harvest, just to help at least weed the taller stuff that you can see. So when you harvest through, you got a cleaner harvest. You don't have to be picking through things. Another thing, just not being so, I'm not so shy, but I know folks have had this issue. Just start. Whether, and it's what I tell my friends, hey, you have a little backyard with, hey, it's just a 20, it's a 20 by 30, but you can put a little eight by three row, a little raised bed right in the corner, and you can grow a lot. You can grow cantaloupes on the edges to let it grow out and over your grass. You can grow right in, towards the back, some okra along the fence and let it grow up, and then some bean to grow up that okra, and something nice in the middle, some arugula or some lettuce that you want to harvest, and perennials go a long way. Mints, oreganos, a lot of the different herbs, they're really great. One thing that I tried to focus on, and that's what I did mostly last year when I didn't have this vision in mind, was trees. So you want to, with trees, you just plop them down. You make sure that they have a little bit of fertilizer and some water for the last them through the year, and some compost or some leaves to cover them up in the winter to make them nice and warm, to make sure they don't get frosted out. However, they just keep growing and you keep reaping as long as you give them a little bit of TLC. The other is asparagus.
I didn't get to show that.
We have two large beds of asparagus. I think like 30 asparagus is enough for 30 crowns of asparagus is enough for a family of four. Asparagus grows for 30 years. Okay, yeah. So like you plant it once, 2 years later you're eating asparagus. That's $6.99 a bushel. At Whole Foods. Sometimes in the off season. So really, those are awesome. If maybe you might not be ready this year, but looking out in the long term, do I want to do this, in a couple years? Maybe my mother is going to, maybe somebody or my father is going to retire, right? And he's going to want something to do. He's going to want to be around the house or be hanging out. Or my wife loves to garden. How can we scale it little by little? Folks start off with an 8 foot like myself in Jersey, and then came to Dallas and, I did like 3 8-foot by 3s. And then, come here, I did a 20 by 30. When I moved to this house, and now, this year I'm like, hey, I got the trees down. Let's see what else we can do. I'm transitioning. Why not? So that's cool. My challenge. The thing I recommend is just start. A lot of folks have a cold feet in the beginning, but there's really, really no need for that. It's easy to start.
One of the things I'm really envious about Jefferson is that he's got his wife who loves the garden into this, and also his mom. So you want to talk about the role and importance of family in your farm?
Sure. So for me, I'm really, I'm a bit of the head of the household. Everybody looks to me. It's just I learn a lot and I do a lot. So they're really looking to me to just guide them along a little bit in terms of things that are new, but in terms of things that are already done and things that are easy to do, they love to take that on, right? My mom, she's been learning every single day. Some weeks is harder than others. Some weeks we do struggle where I'm coming back and say, Mom, why are you watering this why are you watering the whole property by hand? It took you 3 hours of the day. You had other things you could have done. And she'll go through that, but she'll grow, she'll see the value of just taking on the new things and seeing, hey, why not move this is the example, the watering 3 hours a day, you teach them how to use a sprinkler and just point the sprinkler in this direction, adjust it like this and keep it there for 15 minutes and then move it and then go do your own thing, go take care of something else, go run an errand, whatever you want to do, and come back in 15 minutes and move the sprinkler. And you're saving yourself throughout the day. Instead of doing 3 hours dedicated throughout that day, you're doing 1 hour, you're doing a one hour throughout the day, throughout the whole day, right? And that's really the blessing of family. I just can't speak enough on. My mother, she does a lot of the maintenance. She loves to be outside. My wife, not so much. She gets bad reactions to bug bites and so she's been more and more getting outside, but she's really good at on the harvesting, on the packaging, and on selling. So she'll come to me with me to the farmer's market and get out for the day, This is really important when, you know, you're working sometimes 60-hour weeks, 80-hour weeks, depending on what you're doing throughout you know, the different times of the year. Sometimes it's really crunch time, and you want to do some things that are interactive with your family. You don't want to just, hey, I got 40 hours, you got 40 hours, and you got 40. Let's do 20 hours together, and really make 2 + 2 = 6, you know. And that way you're also enjoying each other, and you're learning how to work together, and it's not a disconnect where you come back at the end of the week and say, hey, why is this like that? Well, I didn't know this was like that. You're touching base throughout the week, and you guys are enjoying each other, and it's not so much of like in your own little wow. worlds, and then coming back together. That's one thing that I found really enriched our life. When I was working at Microsoft, just, you know, 12 hour grinds throughout the day, and you're not seeing your family as much. But here, I'm working from home, doing some consulting stuff, doing some Amazon stuff, but also infrastructure on the farm, and I have my mother to really push. On the farm side, and my hand's always coming outside of the picture. And I have my mother to really, you know, provide the maintenance and the day-to-day. She comes out with the kids, puts the kids in a little pool, hanging out next to them and doing doing her thing. And, you know, she's enjoying. I come out and I do 1 hour of heavy lifting or heavy weeding or some heavy, you know, some productive just to make something go forward. And she provides that maintenance that just makes us go to the market. It's been quite an adventure. It's a learning process. It's a lot about being pretty compassionate with each other and learning that not everybody's gonna be as fast as you, or not everybody's gonna be as, you know, as strong as you, or smart as you, or whatever it is that that is your strength or your weakness. You got to work together and find out, you know, hey, this person is good at that. This person might not be so good at that. But sometimes also on the other end, talking and say, hey, this is important. We got to make this happen. Otherwise, we won't make it. So it's a bit of being relaxed, but also sometimes reining in and say, hey, we need to make things happen.
Yeah, and being flexible. Yeah. Cool. So our time's coming to the end. I got a couple more questions for Jefferson. So second to last question is, if somebody's interested out there, watch this episode, got motivated to start their own farm, you know, what advice, really quick, would you give them if somebody was wanting to make their own farm like you've done here successfully, literally just 6 months ago, and now making like $500 a week?
Okay, great. Like I said, starting off small. If you're able, if for some reason it's a crunch in your life, like I need to have a job, I need to make some money, you're not going to be able to really bring something to market for like 3 months, 6 months. And at that, microgreens. Yeah, microgreens. Microgreens. You might, but also microgreens. You have to test some things, and there's a lot of failure and trial too.
Yeah.
Microgreens might be the shortest to get to market, but however, it is a niche. It is a niche product, and you have to educate people. So I'll say this, at our farmer's market table, we do have microgreens. They sell decently, but it's only like 20% of our sales. And I spend probably 80% of my time educating people on microgreens on that sale. I have my wife with me, so she's able to, you know, sell on, you know, whatever somebody, the regulars or the folks that just need one thing or two things, they have the regular vegetables. And so she's able to sell on that. But for me, I have to educate on microgreens and give a sample and bring people to it. Cause you're, you know, if, unless you have a restaurant or you have something that you can, you gotta go other sales channels.
Right.
So microgreens also have their challenges, cropping and this also has their challenges. So you wanna look for the most fertile area in your plot that you have. If you have an area that's close to trees, especially in the South, you'd really have a lot of sun, right? Since you have a lot of sun, you can look at, you know, hey, this is enough sun, and the rest of the shade will actually block out and give them give the plants, some rest so that they can recoup and they're not, you know, scorched. So that'll help. I do that quite a bit. As you saw with the burlap, burlap's really been helping me out. Everybody told me I was not gonna have any lettuce or any arugula. Because the sun makes the ground like 130 degrees, 140 degrees. Not even tomatoes last sometimes.
I know people are gonna say, cover the ground with some wood chips around your crop.
Yeah, that's easy. But when you're going to till, you know, you gotta remove it. So it's a win and a lose. So, and I have a, and so my recommendation: start off small. Know that you're gonna be, you know, going out for 3 months, 6 months. The first year, if you're able to start off early, do a pilot a year before, where you can get that experience. You're really gonna have a lot of things to deal with: soil, watering, crops, sun scorching, you know, animals that might come in and just be eating, you know, and depending on how how urban or rural your area is, you're gonna have to troubleshoot different scenarios. Really try to grow what you're gonna eat. Right, grow into your your expensive food. So try to bring down that vegetable, you know, that vegetable expense that you buy at the store. And if you're starting from scratch, that's what you got to do. That's my recommendation. Don't be like, oh, I'm going to go be a farmer and think you're going to do it. Because in 3 months, you might want to transition, and you already invested all that time, all that labor, and you just demolished your yard, you know, just to have vegetables growing. So start off small. Be focused on going to market. If you're gonna be dedicated and you've already had that experience, focus on going to market. Get a mentor. I don't have a mentor here. I've been reading a lot. I've read a lot of books. I've studied a lot in the last 5 years, and I've picked up Curtis Stone's book, The Urban Farmer. Excellent book on just, you know, getting a baseline as to what this will entail. It's work. It involves a little bit of foresight, but it's just very rewarding. You get to, for myself, if you have like myself, if you have somebody who can be your partner, a family member, and they'll be the, you know, they'll be providing the operations, the day to day, and you can really be the expediter, or you provide I'll be going to the market, I'll be going to the restaurants and selling. I'll do something, and you focus on something else. That'll really help lessen the burden, and maybe help you work on what your strength is. Yeah, that's my recommendation. And then looking at really just staying focused and looking at the customer, what the customer wants. Yeah. If something's not tasty to you, it might be tasty to somebody else, but there's a good chance that it might not, you know, that a lot of folks won't like it, right? And you might have, and so for example, we have a lettuce that we're still growing. It's quite bitter, and most folks aren't used to that because they're used to just conventional lettuce. Even regular lettuce is very earthy, even in winter and in fall, it's very earthy. Some folks might not enjoy it because they prefer just the vinegar or the oil taste on their salads. However, you know, if you you can explain that to customers, especially at farmers market, folks are very forgiving. Hey, this is a bitter tasting lettuce. Try a little bit, see if you like it. If you're not, it's $3. You know, if you do like it, it's $3. You know, whatever is your price or whatever, you know, whatever is your context, explain it, talk to people, be friendly, and folks will love you for it.
Yeah, yeah, I think just mainly be honest. Yeah. Just let them know what's definitely, up, man. Definitely.
Don't try to sell anything that's not, the person's gonna open up that bag and see that it's not good. That's it. They're gonna come back. We had somebody with the microgreens, for example. Microgreens are really finicky, so we're selling whole trays. Okay, whole trays means that a person has to then go water it throughout the weeks. If they don't water it, it dries up. If they water it too much, it molds. Okay, so the first couple folks that bought it, we had feedbacks from one lady. She came back. She said, "Hey, I brought it home and it didn't smell right, and it molded up." Okay, and I said, "Here's your $10." You know, I said it really nice. I was like, "I'm so sorry. Here's your $10. You know, we apologize. You know, sometimes you have to be really compassionate with your customer. You have to know that you have to put yourself in their situation and know that if I would and think, hey, if I was in this situation and I came home with a product that wasn't that, you know, that I paid a good premium on, especially at farmers market or as an organic product, I paid, people don't mind paying a lot of money. People don't mind paying for a good product. They mind paying for a high price for a subpar product or a product that they could go get at a store. I'll pay $5 for a head of lettuce if it is the best lettuce that I've ever had in my life. And I know many people that are the same way. It's just everybody's got their own context in life and what they, you know, what's their thresholds of good and bad, right? So you gotta be accommodating to that. You'll have many people that come up and they just fidget your vegetables or your table, and they're like, and they don't buy anything. You're like, dang, okay, no problem. You know, just fix it up. You know, smile and keep going, right? Because every day will bring something new, and a smile will bring people coming back.
So. Yeah, and that's the other thing, you know, creating a customer base that will keep coming back. You know, and you can only do this by being friendly, having good, you know, produce. And now he's created a customer for life. Even though he had to refund $10, that lady knows, like, hey, that guy's a good guy. He gave me my money back. And some people wouldn't, right? So last question I think I have for you, Jefferson, because it's getting dark. We got to get going. Is how can somebody learn more about you and your farm, buy some of your produce if you're in the area, or even, like, I know you're doing, you know, you want to help teach people and foster growth in this area. Like, share anything that you'd like to put out there to my viewers today.
Sure. So we are at braggafarms.org. That's our landing page. It's not very sophisticated yet. However, our Facebook is really nice. We're at Braga Farms DFW. There's another Braga Farms out in out in California, they do a lot of nuts and a lot of organic nuts. We've been even tagged on their page by accident, which we're trying to get back. We're also on Instagram at Braga Farms DFW. So Braga is B-R-A-G-A Farms DFW, as in Dallas, Fort Worth. You can also visit us at any time if you're in the Dallas area. We are at the Dallas Farmers Market, right in downtown Dallas. Really nice farmers market, a big shed, and also a big interior where there's some good shopping, and there's nice walking areas and plazas and things like that. Please come visit us anytime, and we also have a nice farm. Anytime you'd like to come visit, please just send us a message on Facebook, or give us a call, or pay us a visit at Braga Farms, and we'll be more than glad to have you over. Show you guys the area. If you have any questions, if you'd like to see more, see how we're evolving, just follow us there and give us a shout out. Tell us how we're doing. Tell us what we can improve. I'm sure there's a lot of things we can work on. I'm sure. So all the best for all the other farmers out there, for the aspiring farmers. Good luck to you guys. Let me know if I can help with anything, and I'm always in the area. I'll always make time.
Awesome, man. Yeah, that's another thing. You know, like both me and Jefferson, we try to live in service. You know, I live in service by visiting his farm today and taking time out of my day, like half the day literally, to come here, tour the farm, just chat.
Thank you very much for that.
Oh yeah, no man, my pleasure, man.
We had a blast having you.
Yeah, and then make videos for you guys so that it'll encourage you guys and make the world a better place, you know, and he's here to help others, you know, do a similar thing and help people grow food in the area, which is amazing. So anyways, my time has come to the end. If you guys enjoyed this episode at Braga Farms, give me a thumbs up. Next time I come to Houston, I'll be sure to come back and make another video with an update. I'm sure this is gonna be way better, way nicer, and less weeds, and just I can't wait to see it in the future when I return. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes I have coming out of every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over, I don't know, almost maybe close to 1,300 videos at this time. Teach you guys all aspects on how you guys can grow your own food at home and even make possibly a business out of it, you know, to support you and your family. Finally, be sure to share this video with somebody that's thinking about starting their own farm. They could get motivated to that, how in just 6 months Jefferson was able to do it, and you know, you guys could do it too. Yeah, be sure to check out the video I made with Curtis Stone down below. That'll light some fire underneath your proverbial tush. All right, so with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.